I want one student, please. Can I have Meghna? Is she here? Thank you.
That's exactly the reason why we are doing this, to help you choose the right careers going forward. It's my great pleasure in welcoming Vaishali Patil from Mumbai. She's come all the way to Mumbai just to have these sessions. She has a phenomenal background. She's been training aspirants for the Indian Civil Services, which is the career we're going to talk about today. And it is not just IAS and IPS and IRS. There are many more such careers which are handled under the umbrella of Indian Civil Services. She has been training aspirants along with her husband, around 3,000 students every year, and she's been doing this for the last 30 years. She's got 20 odd centers across Maharashtra, and every district of Maharashtra is represented among the students. Many of her students are now occupying very senior positions in the government across the country, as collectors or secretaries or magistrates and so on. And they recognize the contribution that the school has made in helping them get these kind of careers. I've heard her talk and it's amazing. So I'm sure all of you will enjoy. I'll hand it over to Vaishali. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So I've been here with Parikrama since yesterday. My final interaction for these 2 days with the students of Parikrama, and I am saying my final interaction for these 2 days because I am going away with the hope that there will be many more interactions.
Yes.
And that will happen only when you, as students of Parikrama, for whom all this is being done, will show an interest in the career of civil services, and that is exactly what I hope to do by the end of our discussion. And since there are 9th and 10th graders here and 11th and 12th, so normally since the past 3 interactions that I've had, I have limited the technicalities of this exam to a minimum, because you will be eligible to write the exam once you are a graduate. So there is a presentation which talks about those technicalities, but today's interaction I am going to focus on what you need to build up if you want to aspire to a career in the civil services, what exactly it means to be a civil servant in India, and what are those qualities and what are the tools for achieving or imbibing those qualities in your personality over the next 2 or 3 years, so that you know, when you are eligible to actually write the exam, it becomes not a formidable task that it is made out to be, but it becomes an easy achievable goal for you. Right? The challenge for us today, for me and for the entire Parikrama team, is to keep those dreams, to keep those aspirations alive in you for the next 4 or 5 years, or at least for the next 3 years for the 12th graders. So that continuity, that consistency, that resilience of keeping this dream alive in you is what we are going to look at or focus on today, and hopefully go away with a certain set of tools and skills that you need to, that you can use to achieve this goal. It's also very important for me that you come up with a lot of questions, like ma'am said very rightly, or rather as everybody calls everybody here, Akka said very rightly. The more number of questions you ask, okay, it's not for your good, it's for my good. I get to learn a lot. Okay, so if you think that Akka needs to learn something from us, please feel free to ask me any kind of questions, however silly they might sound to you. And in the past 3 interactions, I've noticed that most of the kids are more interested in asking about Akka, what do you do, Akka, where do you stay, which is good. But also please ask me about Akka, how we should do this, and what is this, and what is that, and you didn't tell us about this. I will be more than happy to do that. Right? So my interaction with you is going to be beginning with a story and ending with a story, and being interspersed with many stories of real life people like you and me, who started with nothing and who are today very famous, very effective, very popular officers in the government, in the civil service. So starting off with the story of a little boy. So there was this little boy who was very naughty, and it was vacation time, no school, afternoon time, all the friends had gone home to sleep or whatever. And this boy was so naughty and he had nothing to do, so he thought of a prank. And what he did was, he got a glass jar, okay, with a lid. He opened the lid and he trapped a few flies in it. So the flies went inside the jar and then he put the lid on top. So when he put the lid, what would the flies do when they are trapped in the jar? They will try to escape, right? But he had put the lid on top of it. So when they tried to escape, it hurt their head and they settled down in the jar. Okay, now after some time, what is going to happen? They are going to die. So the mother came along, luckily for the flies, and she saw that and she said, hey, what have you done? Why have you trapped those flies in the jar? They will die because of lack of oxygen. So she removed the lid. So now once she's removed the lid, what are they supposed to do? Fly off. But surprisingly, the flies did not fly off because the lid had hurt their head so many times. Now that the lid was off also, they were afraid to fly, thinking that the lid is still there and it is going to hurt them. So this is exactly the situation that we are in, my friends. We are those flies trapped in that jar of society, okay? And the lid that is placed on our head is, you are poor, you are not going to a very high-end school, you don't know this, you don't know that. Okay, in Maharashtra, it's very common for us to say, you don't know English, but you guys know English so well, I am so happy to see this. And I'm going to go back and tell all my students over there that you should learn from the Parikrama students. So you are not confident, okay, you don't come first in class, all those are the lids. You have these problems at home, okay, all those are the lids which our society places on our head, as a result of which people like Parikrama and this whole team, which is so hardworking and still so caring about you, they remove those lids. This process that they have of calling various people and making sure you get exposure and interaction is a process of removing those lids from your jar of life so that you can fly. Right? So just do not be afraid or worried, or do not hold yourself back from taking that flight, because at the end of the day, that is what we all want. We want that each and every one of you should have flown high enough to make us look up and wonder, oh, these are the children who are coming here for this session, right? So on that note, I'll make a beginning of taking you through my presentation interspersed with a lot of stories. Yes, so we are primarily going to talk about career in the civil services. And when you say civil services, it means, of course, these very popular first four short forms, which is IAS, IPS, IFS and IRS. Do you know what they stand for? Yes? IAS means? Right, IPS? Wonderful. IFS? Foreign Service. And IRS? They don't need any talks. They know all this. That's wonderful. So, IAS, IPS, IFS, IRS, and then what is PO? PO is a bank probationary officer, which is like an assistant manager in a nationalized bank. Then GC is deputy collector, so somebody who gets selected to the state for the state government. And the first four are from for the central government, Government of India. Then DYSP is deputy superintendent of police. TAH is Tehsildar. PSI is police sub-inspector, and so on and so forth. So when we go to the next slide, please. We will see what exactly do you understand by the civil service. Okay. So all of you have civics as a subject in school, right? And you talk about the Indian Constitution. Yes. What is the Indian Constitution? Sorry? Set of rules. What else? Come on, be free. You know it. volume. I'm not taking your test on Indian Constitution. I just need to know what you think of the Indian Constitution. So the Indian Constitution is one book, okay, which is a guideline, which is a spirit about how this country should work as a democracy. It is the soul of the government and how the government should work for the welfare of the people. Okay, it is an indicator for the citizens of this country what are their rights and what are their duties. So it should be one of the most read, okay, most studied, most loved and most respected books in this country. So when you become a civil servant, you become a civil servant with the power that the Indian Constitution vests in you. As a civil servant, your primary responsibility is to the Constitution of India. It is not to the politicians. Because as a civil servant, whose servant are you? The public servant, right? You are the government. And in a democracy, a government is for the people, of the people, and by the people. So you are a servant of the people. And that power, that authority comes to you from the Constitution of India. So when you become an IAS, IPS or any officer, your appointment is signed by the President of India, nobody less than that. Or if you get appointed to the state government, it is signed by the governor of the state. Okay, so your power to make a difference comes from the Indian Constitution, and therefore when you are studying civics henceforth, please pay a lot of attention and love, give a lot of love to studying the Constitution, because it's going to be your guiding light. Even if you don't take up the civil services as a career, the Constitution is still going to be your guiding light to be a good citizen inside. Right? So, if any service that comes under the government, except for the armed forces are different category. It's an armed military service, and this is the civil service. So, what you do in the civil society. Okay, it looks after the welfare of the people, as we will see in further slides. It protects the citizens. So how it looks after the welfare of the people? So when you, if you become an IAS officer at the young age of 21, once you are a graduate, because you have to be a minimum graduate to write the exam, and if you get selected, by the time you are 24 or 25, as a young IAS officer, you are given the charge of a district. So, any small district in India has a budget of thousands of crores of rupees. Because India is a very populated country, it is the second largest population. So, lot of its bigger states like Madhya Pradesh or Maharashtra or even Uttar Pradesh, their population is equal to small countries in the world. And so, their welfare budget is of thousands of crores of rupees, and that is the kind of budget. These are the kind of resources that are made available to you as an IAS officer to use for the welfare of the people. No other career will give you so many opportunities or so much authority to make a direct difference in the life of the people like a civil service career. Right? So it looks after the welfare of the citizens. It protects the citizens. So if you become a police officer, then it becomes your job to protect the citizens from any kind of harm, to make sure that law and order is maintained in society so that developmental work can take place. It ensures that they get their rights and serve their duties. So if you have any problem where you will go, you go to the police station. And if you are not following your duties as a citizen, if you are not voting, if you are not littering, it is also the responsibility of the civil servant to make sure that you do that. Right? So it gives you your rights, and it also makes sure that it makes you do your duties as a citizen of India. That is a job of the civil services. It implements the vision of the leaders. Okay? So our Prime Minister Modiji, he introduced this Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Everybody knows about it. So that was his vision. He saw this, that we need to clean up our country so that the citizens lead a healthy life and so that good development takes place. So just having the vision is not enough. It is important, but it is not enough. So that is one wheel of the cart of democracy, that leaders should have a vision. But the second important wheel is that vision has to become a reality in day-to-day life. Right? So how that becomes? with the help of this entire army of civil servants, they will formulate the policies, write down the rules, make sure that it is within the framework of the constitution, then develop a mechanism in the administration to make sure that this action is carried out. So then in the local area, you have the talatis and the gram sevaks and everybody working. They organize this daily cleaning activities, and then they put up those posters and make those awareness campaigns that, you know, don't litter, keep your city green. Then they have these competitions among villages, that which is the cleanest village. So the vision of Swachh Bharat, which the Prime Minister has been translated into a vibrant reality in our country because of this work of the civil service. So that is what the civil service does. So this is your, what is this? What does this picture tell you? It's your life cycle. So when you are born, who is there with you when you are born, when you are a baby? Your mother. Then when you go to school?
Teacher.
And when you go to college, you have your friends and whatever, girls and boyfriends, college teachers and all that. And then you get married, you have your spouse and your children. You go to work, you have your colleagues. Then you become old and you don't know whether anybody is there with you or not. Okay, you might be in an old age home. And then you die. So in these, no, it's not done. In these different stages of life, you have different people who are there with you, then they are not there with you anymore, and then a different set of people are there with you. But there is one aspect which is continuously there with you from your birth to your death, and that is the civil service. Never leaves you. How is that? So, when you are born, your birth certificate. Made in the Tehsildar's office. Then for your school admission, your Aadhaar card and all those forms, government office. Then when you go to college, your college admission, for that you need all those domicile certificate and this and that, all comes from the government office. You want to start your business, you have to get permissions, you have to get shop and establishment, you have to pay rent, for that you need an agreement, you have to open a bank account, government documents are important. You get married, your marriage registration happens from there. You grow old, your pension will not come unless you have your age ID proof, Aadhaar card, this, that, okay. And then when you die, unless the government or the civil service issues your death certificate, your family will not get your insurance money, your property. So this one entity which is there with you throughout your life in India is the civil service. So we saw that one great vision of the leader, like Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, so big. Or Modi, he went to America right now, you know, he met Trump and there was this howdy Modi, and then Trump called him the father of India and all that happened. Big deal, right? It was made such a big deal. Lot of agreements were made between the two leaders that, you know, they will oppose Pakistan or that they will give us trade priority in trade and all that. So just shaking hands and talking on stage will not make it a reality. That great vision will become a reality when all the foreign service officers, they will sit together, then they will draft those terms and conditions, then they will sign it and actually make it happen. So you see, right from those big, big visions and big, big plans for the growth of the country to this day-to-day reality of your life, from that level to this level, everywhere, who is constant? So it may be an IAS officer of the top level, it may be an IFS officer of the top level, or it may be a simple gram sevak or talati or tehsildar, but at every level, this civil service is what becomes the framework of the development of the country. And this is a village. India is the land of the villages, right? They say that. And now what has happened because of development? Lot of these villages also want amenities like cities. So when you go to your village, so now you have 4G and you have cable network and Amazon delivers there, and you know, electricity never goes out. So there are machines in the farms and 24/7 water supply. There is a tap water coming in the village. All that is happening because of the hard work and because of the training of the civil servants. In a lot of villages in Karnataka, they have this water dispenser na, at the gram panchayat level. So you put in that much money and you get one day supply of water for the whole family. So we see that on one hand water is becoming scarce, so the administration has come up with this wonderful facility for villagers where they get clean drinking water from a machine. The civil service is important. Like we have seen, the civil service is important because it forms the steel frame of growth in the country. Okay. It provides stability and continuity. So politicians will come and go. 6 months back, Karnataka had a different chief minister, right? Today they have a different chief minister. So politicians, they fight the elections, they contest the elections, and we vote them in a democracy. But they are not constant. But a civil servant, once he is appointed, he cannot be removed from the job. Why? Because his power comes from the constitution. So once you become an officer in the government, unless you do something very wrong, like, you know, take a lot of bribe and you are caught red-handed, or you go ahead and murder somebody or something like that, you cannot be removed from your job. So you are there 100%. Right? So there is continuity in policy. It is a trained workforce. A politician never gets any training. Like a lot of the ministers, they say that we contested the elections and now here we are, we don't know what we are supposed to do, nobody to tell us, except for our secretaries, who are the civil servants. So ultimately, if as a civil servant you are good at your job, then the politician will also listen to you because he knows that you know better than him because you are trained. So once you get selected by the UPSC, you have a 6-month foundation program in Mussoorie. There is this Lal Bahadur Shastri Institute for Administrative Services in Mussoorie. And the best of the people come to train you there, and after that the government pays for your Bharat Darshan. So they take you around the entire country to see what your country is like before you join the job. Okay, so there's a lot of training that goes on, and it is manned, the civil services is manned by people like you who are hardworking, who are with high integrity and who are persistent. So this training and this entire process of the examination, it develops you as a person, and that is exactly what we are going to try and understand, what you need to do to be able to reach this level. What exactly are these services? I've been saying civil service and it comes from the constitution. So broadly there are two categories, that is the central services where you can get recruited through exams conducted by the Union Public Service Commission, UPSC it is called, and the UPSC civil service exam is conducted once every year. So the UPSC is also a constitutional body, it is mentioned in the constitution, so it is not under the pressure of any kind of political establishment, right? That is the UPSC. And then the state government, so you have, every state has their own public service commission. So Karnataka has the KPSC. So once you are a graduate, you can even write the KPSC exams and get selected as a civil servant. Then there is the judiciary. What do you understand by judiciary? The law, the judges, the courts. So those services where you can, if you are a graduate in law, you can start working as a public prosecutor or as a junior magistrate first class and then progress from there. The banking, the nationalized banks, where you can give one exam and then you can become a bank assistant manager in a bank and rise to the level of the chairman of that bank. Okay, but this applies only to nationalized banks. You know the meaning of nationalized banks? So what are the nationalized banks that you know? SBI, yes. Not SBI, that's a private bank. Sorry. Reserve Bank of India, it's not like a regular bank, but yes, it is the most important and biggest banking organization in our country. So yes, you can become an officer in the RBI also by giving the exams which are conducted by the RBI selection board. Then there is LIC and then there is Indian Railways. So the railways is one of the biggest employers in the whole of Asia. There are a lot of job opportunities. There are a lot of job opportunities available to youngsters to become a part of the Indian Railway administrative systems and technical systems also. And then the local self-government, like at the corporation level, there is board officer, then there are other engineering jobs, and then there are Gram Sevak and Talati at the village level. So all these jobs are available to you as a civil servant. And of course the most glamorous ones are the IAS, IPS, IFS, IRS. But you should know this, that when you appear for the UPSC civil service exam, there are a total of 32 cadres, which includes these four, and it includes a lot of other cadres like in the customs, in the income tax, it includes in the Indian corporate law services, in the post and telegraph service, in the railway traffic system. So there are totally 32 cadres to which you can get selected, and each one of them has equal pay, perks and benefits. Right? What are the benefits? So like I said, there is 100% job security. Once you are selected, you will get regularly promoted, and unless you do something very wrong, they will not throw you out of the job. Not like a private company, where if the company does not do well, you will get a 2-line letter saying please don't come from tomorrow. So there are no benefits, nothing. You are there today, you are not there tomorrow. And in a private company, you are working for the profit of that company. But when you are working in the government, you are working for the benefit of society at large. So the job satisfaction is also very high. It's a good pay. For a class 2 officer who has just joined, the pay is starting at 50,000 rupees per month. And for a senior level IAS, IPS officer, it goes to more than 2 lakhs. So in Maharashtra, the additional chief secretary of Maharashtra is currently drawing a salary of more than 2.5 lakhs, which is more than the salary of the governor of the state. Okay, as per the 7th pay coming there, that's a reality. So, 100% job security, good pay, very good perks, the government will give you a house, a car, servants, and so much social prestige. So, one of our students who is an IAS officer placed in Chandigarh, his name is Ajit Joshi. He was travelling from Chandigarh to Delhi, and then he had to take a flight and come to Mumbai for some work. And one of his friends who was a CEO in a multinational company, he was also travelling. So he told Ajit that, look, I have a BMW, what do you have, government ambassador car? So let's go in my car. It is so posh and so fast and so good. And we will talk about our college days and have fun on the way to Delhi. So Ajit said, no, I am going in official capacity, so I have to travel in the government car, the ambassador. If you want, you join me in my car so that we can chat and go. So the friend was grumbling a lot that, hey, what, this khatara gadi, I have to go, and now my BMW is so good. But for friendship's sake, he traveled with Ajit, and then what happened along the highway, there was a huge traffic jam and the car had to stop. So all the villagers, when they saw that the collector's car was there, they all came running to meet him, they started touching his feet, they offered him tea, coffee, that sir, you have been standing over here. They told him, this is the shortcut, we will take you like this. And that friend in the, who was the CEO of a multinational company, he was shocked. He said, they saw your car and they came running to you. If I would have been in my BMW, nobody would have bothered about it. So that is the kind of social prestige that you get once you become an officer with the government. Provided you do good work. If you don't do good work, then those very people will throw stones on you. So it all depends on the kind of work that you do. And you are selected in this position with the hope and with the wish and with the training that you will do a good job which is entrusted to you. So it's a very responsible position, and it gives you a lot of power and authority to make a positive change. So one very good example of that is the recent commissioner of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation. So the BSC buses in Mumbai, you know those red buses, right? So they were losing their passengers because suddenly the BSC had increased the fare a lot. And then people were preferring to travel by two-wheelers or take those Olas and Ubers or share an auto and all that. And then when Mr. Praveen Singh Patesi got appointed as the commissioner of Mumbai, he decided that he had to do something about this. And he did a very smart thing. He said that the job of the BST is to provide good, cheap transport to the citizens. So he made the ticket price half. So for a distance of 2 kilometers, people had to first pay 15 rupees. Now suddenly they had to pay only 7 rupees. And so suddenly people in Mumbai started to leave their two-wheelers at home. So the traffic decreased. The congestion on the roads of Mumbai decreased, the bus service improved, and the connections of the BST also went very high. And people are so happy because nobody likes to drive a two-wheeler in traffic. There is so much pollution and so much danger to your life. It is better to travel by bus and it is so affordable. So then the BST started new facilities like air-conditioned buses, and they started smaller size buses for smaller routes. And today the BST for a small short route distance, they take you from one place to another in 2 rupees, which nobody does. That is the kind of authority you get to make a positive change which directly affects a life. Right? So now who can become an officer like this? So anybody who is a citizen of India, minimum 21 years of age, and a graduate from any university can become a civil servant. They do not even ask you which university, they don't ask you whether you became a graduate in the first attempt, they don't ask you if you got a first class in your graduation. Even people with 35% marks in their graduation can attempt the exam, and they have attempted and become very good officers. And I'm going to share a few real life examples of people like that. Okay, so the first example is of Mr. Dilip Kharde. Currently he is a district magistrate in one of the districts in Maharashtra. So Dilip's father was working as a sweeper in the government sales tax building, and then when he was in 10th grade his father passed away. So there was no support, he had to work, he didn't get his father's job because he was too young. There was a gap of 10 years between his 10th standard and his 12th standard, his POC. A gap of 10 years. Okay? And then after he did his POC, he got a job in his father's place. What was that job? Of a sweeper in the sales tax office. And he used to see all those officers and he used to wonder how I can become an officer like that. And then somebody told him that you have to be a graduate for this. So he wrote his graduation exam. With no support, okay, he was working as a sweeper, mind you, while he wrote his graduation exam. And then he gave the exam and he got selected as a deputy collector in Maharashtra. And after 15 years of serving as a deputy collector, today he has been promoted to IAS and he is a collector in one of the districts in Maharashtra. So, what background is that? It's not like he had a car dropping into the poshest of schools and colleges. No, with so much difficulties, he was able to achieve this. This person whom you are seeing over here is Mr. Bharat Andre. I have a few of his books for your library. You can refer to that. So Bharat comes from a very small village in Nasik district of Maharashtra, and nobody in his family was even 7th pass. Okay, so his grandmother had this big desire, and very poor family. So his grandmother had this big desire that my Bharat should be at least 7th pass. So he studied up to 7th standard and he passed. And he used to help his grandmother carry those sacks of onion, because Nasik is a very famous onion trading and producing center. So he used to carry those sacks of onion from the godown to the truck, and from the truck to the godown, and fill those onions, and you know, then it used to go for selling. And he used to earn 15-20 rupees every day doing that for 12 hours. But that money was important for his family because it used to bring food in the family. They were that poor. Okay? And then he used to see his neighbor's son is going to the city of Nasik. And he asked him, what do you do there? He said, I go to the ITI. Now what is ITI? ITI is Industrial Training Institute. So they train you to become a plumber or a mechanic or a electrician and those kind of trades. So he said, how much salary you get? So that friend told him, I get 700 rupees a month. So Bharat was very interested because hey, he was making 15 rupees every day and then 700 to 1000 rupees a month. So he said, I want to. So the friend told him, you have to complete your 10th standard. So he told his mother, I want to do my 10th standard. Mother said, hey, you will go to the city and there is no school over here. You will not bring those 15, 20 rupees you are bringing home every day. So he had nothing doing. I want to do that. And on his own, he went there and he studied in the ITI. He was learning this trade. And then he saw another person from his neighboring village going on a bike, wearing a nice smart uniform. He asked, what is this? Then I have become a PSI. PSI is police sub-inspector. It's a class 3 post. How do you become a PSI? So he said, you have to write the exam, but before that you have to get a degree, you have to become a graduate. Then Bharat said, now I want to become a graduate. So he enrolled in the open university there and working very hard. So he had to send at least 600 rupees a month home, no? Because otherwise there would be no food at home. So that he was doing, working with the ITI and preparing for his graduation. And then he wrote the exam after graduation, he became a PSI. And then when he became a PSI, he chanced upon our magazine and he said, hey, there is something called IAS also. And then there is this, what do you have to be an IAS? So you have to be a graduate again. And he said, then I can, I am a graduate now, might as well try that. But you can't be a graduate by staying in Nasik, so he had to come to Pune. And he didn't know anybody in Pune, he had no money, he had to quit his job. Okay, and then because he did all that, he had no face to show his family, he couldn't go back to the village. It took him 4-5 years to prepare for that exam and become successful. But till then in the village, everybody had said, Bharat has gone mad. He has gone to Pune, so he's admitted in the mad hospital. Oh, he's run away with a Muslim girl, that's why he's not coming. Those kind of rumors, somebody told his grandmother he died. And she was so distraught. And then finally, when he got selected after 5 or 6 years, he went back to his little village. And those very people who were making fun of him and his family were there to felicitate him and to greet him. And today, he is working as a IRS officer in Ahmedabad, as an income tax commissioner. So what is Bharat's background? Okay, what is Dilip's background? They didn't have a school like Parikrama, which was, helping them out and making sure that they got good education. These people did it on their own without any support. In fact, with a lot of negative inputs from relatives and family and friends. And in spite of that, they could achieve this. This is Kunal Kumar. His story is very, very different. Okay, so Kunal Kumar was a topper in the engineering entrance exam in India. He came first. He got admission in IIT Mumbai. He did his engineering from IIT Mumbai. Then he appeared for the management entrance exam, which is CAT. And he came first in that also in India. And he did his MBA from IIM Ahmedabad, one of the best management colleges in this country. And then, as it happens in IIMs, he got selected by Citibank for a job which paid him 1 crore rupees a year. Okay, and as his first posting was in America, where he was coordinating a conference organized by Citibank, and that conference was about all the deans and vice chancellors of all universities from the world had come to talk about various educational policies. And one of the topics of discussion was, which are the toughest exams in the world, which are the toughest exams for careers throughout the world. And then they were debating, and then they came up with a list. So the fifth toughest exam in the world was India's engineering entrance exam, the JEE. And Kunal Kumar thought, top this. He was very proud of himself. Right? Then the fourth toughest exam in the world was the civil service exam of China. They also have a civil service exam. So the third toughest exam in the world was the management entrance exam of India, that is CAT. So Kunal Kumar was again double proud, no, because he had topped that also. Super proud of himself. The second toughest exam in the world, they said, was the civil service exam of France. And the toughest exam in the world, those experts said, is the civil service exam of India. And Sunal Kumar had no idea about it. He said, ye kya hai? What is this? I have taught these two toughest exams and now this is also from my country. So I want to top that. So he quit his job with Citibank, came back to Delhi, prepared for the UPSC exam. And he got a rank of something 200 plus, he didn't top it, mind you. And he is also working as an IAS officer in Maharashtra. Currently, he is the commissioner of the Pune Municipal Corporation. So you saw Dilip, you saw his background, you saw Bharat, you saw his background and his struggle, and Kunal Kumar, very different background, but today working at the same level with the same salary, same perks, same facilities, same authority, same power, everything. So what I want to say is, we can go further. Background does not matter. What matters is how you prepare for this exam and how well you do in the training and the job. You may be from any background. Another example, Sameer Wankhede. Born and brought up in Mumbai, in the most filmy area of Mumbai called Lokhandwala complex. So all the TV stars and all the celebrities, all the movie stars, you can see them in those cafes and hotels and gyms, working out, walking on the street. So he was also very filmy. Long hair, earrings, new car every day, father was very rich, new girlfriend also every week. And he used to, yeah, I'm telling, I have taught him, so I know. And he used to come to class like that, very naughty in the class also. But something clicked. And then he got selected in the IB, which is the Intelligence Bureau, as an inspector. And he was working in this Coorg region in Karnataka. So the IB is a very secret job, okay? And he was posted in a very remote area. And he had no access, but he qualified the UPSC prelims, he prepared for the mains, and then he got selected as IRS. And today he is posted with the National Investigative Agency, NIA, which is the topmost agency in India, which deals with stopping the counter-terrorist activities in India. Like, you know, they try to stop the activities of ISIS and Al-Qaeda and all that kind of work this person today he is doing for the country. What it tells you is that you might be from any background. You might have any kind of problems in your life. Like Bharat and Dilip, they had problems of scanty, nothing they had. That was their problem. People like Kunal Kumar and Sameer, they had problems of plenty, everything they had. So that is also a problem. Okay? So this way or that way, if you get selected, then everybody is at the same level. So now, UPSC and me, eating on Hindi. Okay? What are the problems? Yes. So you are thinking like, it's too tough. She already said it's the toughest exam in the world. I'm not a topper. I don't have enough money. And in Maharashtra, we have an additional problem. I don't know English. So these are all the problems that students think of when we tell them that you must attempt the exam. But if you look at Bharat, he barely managed to get 35% in his 10th, in his graduation, because you see the conditions in which he was taking his education. Or Dilip Halde, he did his entire education externally. Okay? So that being a topper, if you want, being a topper is not important. So it is the toughest exam in the world. But trust me, if you prepare for this exam, it is one of the best personality development exercises that you can undertake. And you can make a beginning to do that from your school days, from right now. Okay? Now, how you can do that? So you have, like, anybody who comes to us for counseling saying that we want to write the IAS exam, the first thing we tell them to do is, you have to read all your textbooks from 6th standard to 12th standard. Yeah, that's the basis. Okay? So you are already doing that. So you have topics like history, geography, you have topics like civics, right? So now let us take the example of civics. So everybody knows Indian Constitution and you know Article 370? Yes or no? Article 370 was in the news also recently, because it directly affected Kashmir and then they removed it from the constitution. So when you read this in your textbook, what is article? Well, let us talk about fundamental rights. Everybody knows fundamental rights? Okay? So right to education was introduced as a fundamental right in the Constitution of India, Article 21. So that is right to life and liberty. So you know the constitution, you know that right to education has become a fundamental right. So when you are thinking about these things, you should be able to connect these two things. Okay? Or simple things like when you're studying geography. So learn, practice to make a freehand drawing of the map of the world, of the map of India, of the map of Karnataka. Once you learn to make a freehand drawing with your own, look at the map and it will go wrong 5 times, 10 times. But one day will come when you will get the idea of where each country in the world is. Where is the Pacific Ocean? The Prime Minister went to China, so where is China? Where is Estonia? Where is Indonesia? Once you get a clarity on that, or even India, somebody tells you Jharkhand. Where is it? You're not sure. But if you practice the map, these ideas will become so clear in your mind that next time somebody talks about it or you read about anything somewhere, it will make an impact on you. Take part in school activities, or when you go somewhere, you go for a movie, you watch a movie, try and understand the process of the movie, try and understand the story, how it is in reality, what are the laws that are guided in movie making. You see that certificate which comes in the movie, it tells you a lot of things about how a movie can be made in this country, what are the laws about it. So the moment you start connecting your day-to-day activities with what you are studying in school, it will make a lot of impact, and that is going to be the first tool for you to develop your personality, to climb this mountain of success. I'm not a talker in public. So we saw what Bharat was. Okay, so these are three examples. So this is Vishwas Namre Patil. He's one of the most iconic IPS officers in Maharashtra today. And he was studying in a college in Kolhapur, and he was so naughty, they were going to rusticate him from college. Okay, and then today he is one of the most felicitated and sought after IPS officers. Or we saw how Sameer Mankade was. Or this is Vikram Khalate, he comes from Baramati, which is Sharad Pawar's constituency, very powerful family. Today even he is working with NIA, doing a great job there. So you don't have to be a topper, you can be one of the most wasted students. Like for example, one of our students, Sanjay Jadhav, he was currently commissioner in the Nanded police, and he got transferred to Mumbai, and his work was so good that the people took out a procession on their own. They didn't, nobody had to tell them. On their own they took out a procession protesting against his transfer. They wanted him to remain there. And Sanjay, when he was a student, his father was very sure that this boy is going to be wasted in life, not do anything. But today, as a police officer, he has so much respect and so much prestige and love of the people. I can't spend money. So how much money do you think you have to spend to attempt the civil services exam? So there is an exam fees that you have to pay. And if you are from the reserve category or from the EWS, that is economically weaker sections, that exam fee is also waived off. And if your teachers and Akka and Parikrama, they come to know that you want to attempt the civil services, I am sure they go all out and give you all the support and the coaching that you need. Study Circle is always there, one phone call away, to give you all the support that you need. So you don't have to spend a lot of money. So what is it that is common in everybody that they look at when they select you for this exam? That comes in one word, okay, which is Atma. What is Atma? Soul. And when you spell Atma in English, it is A-T-M-A. So each of these alphabets stands for something. The first A of Atma stands for your attitude, aptitude, awareness and alertness. So what is your attitude towards your career goals? Are you going to use the aptitude, the strength, the education that you are getting to achieve your goals? Your attitude has to be very strong, resilient and positive. You should know what is your aptitude, what are your strengths, what are your weaknesses. You have to be aware about your emotions from within. And you have to be alert about what is going on in the surroundings. So you have so much access to the internet. Or I'm sure a lot of newspapers will be coming to your school. Or if you ask them to get some newspapers, they're not going to deny that. So spend 5 minutes reading the newspaper, understanding what is happening in the world. That is the first thing. The T in Atma stands for your thought ocean, how you think. So your thoughts should be positive, they should be balanced, and they should be productive. Whatever thought you have, it should be towards achieving your goal. Don't think about thoughts which are wasted. Don't think about negative thoughts. Don't have negative thoughts and have a balanced thought. The M in Atma stands for your mindset or your emotional quotient. And your mindset should always be empathic. Try to understand the other person's problem. Because as an officer or as a good citizen or as a lawyer or any profession you take up, unless you understand the other person's problem, you are not going to find solutions. So be empathic and be inclusive in your emotions. Take everybody along with you. Form a group of 3-4 people who want to take up a career in the civil service. Help each other, decide on what topics you're going to read up and discuss about. Once a week you can have a discussion on any common topic which is happening in the world, like the Nobel Prize for example. So Abhijit Banerjee got the Nobel Prize, he's from India, for economics this year. So find out about it, discuss with your friends, have an inclusive mindset. And the last A, which is very important according to me, is your approach and your aspiration and your action. So having this mindset, this thought process, what action you take towards achieving your career goals, that is very important. And at this point of time in your life, your aspirations are very important. So you have to aspire to be at the topmost levels of whatever career you choose. So if you want to become a civil servant, you should say, one day I'm going to become the DGP of Karnataka. What is DGP? DGP is the Director General of Police, the topmost police post in this state. Or you can say, I'm going to become the Chief Secretary of Karnataka. Or I'm going to become the Cabinet Secretary of India. Having a dream and aspiring to a dream does not cost you anything. In fact, it propels you, it makes you go forward with a positive mindset, with a lot of strength and courage. So aspire. You want to be a lawyer? You say that you will become a lawyer like Harsh Savla. You know who he is? Harsh Savla. Sorry, he's a Maharashtrian. He takes only the biggest cases and he charges lakhs of rupees by the hour to fight. Just go and stand in the court for Salman Khan's case, he took 5 lakh rupees. Just to stand there for half an hour and to get the date extended. That is all. So you want to be an actor? You should aspire to become like Bachchan or Shah Rukh Khan. Not like any small actor. Okay, I'm sorry, I don't know a lot of Karnataka CEOs. I just know Chiranjeevi and Nagarjuna. And I don't even know if they are from Karnataka. So, yeah. I heard Yash, there's something called Yash, who's very popular. So, you want to become a politician? Don't aspire to be like any of these small time politicians. Aspire to become a statesman. Aspire to become like Modi or somebody like Bill Clinton or somebody like Barack Obama, of that level. That is very important. Right? So I'm going to leave you with one more small story, which is very important. It's a mythological story, but it's very important for you when you're planning your career. So, you know, when God was distributing life, so all the species, like men, women, and all the animals were standing in a queue, and God decided that I will give everybody equal life. Okay, so he said, I will give 25 years to everybody. So he gave man 25 years, he gave elephant 25 years, tiger 25 years of life. Right? So man was not happy with 25 years. You know how we are, so greedy all the time. So then man said, hey, what I will do with 25 years here? I want more life. So then he said, Agni, whom should I ask? So he said, donkey does not have a lot of sense. Let me ask him. So he said, he requested to donkey, please give me, no, some 20 your life. So donkey said, okay, I will keep some years and you take the remaining. So he got life, extra life, man got extra life, right? Still not happy. So then he said, now whom I should ask? Then he said, dog is man's best friend. So let me ask the dog. So he requested to the dog. So all the dogs came together, they gave some years of their life. So man got another 25. So now man's life has become 75 years because he got some life from the dog, even some life from the dog. So now it's become, so still he's saying, a century, so I have to meet. So then he said, now whom should I ask? So then he thought, I'll ask the owl. Because the owl is supposed to be very intelligent, so I will request him will understand and will give me, and then I will give him. Okay? So now man has 100 years. Now try to understand, his first 25 years are of what God has given him, of man. 25 to 50 years from whom he got? So you have to work hard like a donkey in that 25 to 50 years of him. Okay, then 50 to 75 years? So whatever you have earned in 25 to 50 years, you have to sit and guard like a dog. And then 75 to 100 years? So what hour does? Sleep in the day, sleep awake in the night. So after 25, please try to understand your life. If you want it to be a human being's life, then whatever you want to achieve in your career, you have to achieve by the time you are 25. We will give you some age relaxation by the time you are 30. But after that, otherwise, if you don't achieve your career goals with all the resilience and the consistency and the strength by the time you are 30, then your rest of the life is like a donkey, then dog, then owl. Remember that and have your career plan set. And Parikrama, I'm sure, is there to help you in whatever it is that your dreams are, to make them a reality. On that note, it was a real pleasure and a privilege to be a part of this Parikrama family, and I'm sure I'm a part of it for my whole life. And I hope that some of you will take this up as a career option, and one day you will be called to your very school as a chief guest, as an IAS, IPS officer who was part of Parikrama's students and now they are. Okay, it is conducted in, there is another presentation which has all the details. To tell you in a nutshell, it is conducted in three stages as of now. The prelims, the mains and the interview. Okay, so in one attempt you have to clear all three. And once you clear that, depending on your marks that you get and the preferences that you tell the government, you will get the various posts like IAS, IPS. So if you are a topper and if you say that your first preference is IAS, you will get IAS. If you're not a topper and at the bottom of the list, then you will get whatever you get at those marks. But still, it will be a class 1 or a class 2 post with the Government of India. Right? So it is just one exam in three stages. Okay. Yeah. Now we have this question, what are the skills? Yeah, not earning. What are the skills we need to get this job? So the first skill, like I discussed, Atma. So at this stage, you need to develop your personality as per, those are the very skills that I looked at. Then other important things that we discussed are how you can relate what you study in your textbooks to day-to-day life. So cultivate good habits of keeping in touch with what is going on in the world. Okay, but make your value system very strong. So values like discipline, values like hard work, values like respecting your elders are very important. Okay. Develop a strong memory so that once you read something, you remember it. That is important. And you are at the right age. Okay? So you are already studying those textbooks. Just study them with a more interesting perspective, keeping in mind this goal. Right? Then they look at certain skills like decision-making ability. Okay? So when you are in a tricky situation, what decision you take? What are the criteria that you apply when taking a decision? So as a good officer, you should be able to keep your personal emotions aside and take a decision which helps the entire community, most of the people in the community. So develop that attitude from you. You have a small decision to take in your family also. Make sure that you take a decision which will help everybody. Develop a good hobby. Like you might have a simple hobby like listening to music. But like Swami Vivekananda said always, that great people don't do great things. They do small, small things with sincerity. So whatever hobby it is, even if it is listening to music, understand what music you are listening to. Understand what are the various kinds of music in this world. What is Indian music? What is classical music? So once you do things in depth, that will automatically lead up to that very quality of understanding a problem at its root cause. right? So these are, make it a habit to never lie. It's a very basic thing. But as an administrator or as a good citizen or as a good human being, you should be have the courage. It's very easy to lie and get away, but it needs a lot of courage to stand up and speak to people. So be in a difficult situation, but stick to the truth, stick to your values. That will automatically add up to you getting success in the exam. Okay? Yes. And I do hope that in the next few years, some of you will be good officers and you will come and guide your own school. Thank you so much.
Thank you.